Welcome to Season 3 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, the topic is the relationship between obesity and COVID-19. I hear from three scientists who are part of the novel coronavirus research compendium at Johns Hopkins, which is online at ncrc.jhsph.edu. First up is Lauren Pietluck, a graduate student in epidemiology at Vanderbilt, who explains a study published early in the pandemic in the Annals of Internal Medicine. She is followed by Dr. Sabina Haberlin, a faculty member in epidemiology here at Johns Hopkins, who tells me about a recent study on obesity and COVID published by the CDC. Finally, Dr. Nicholas Wada describes an innovative study in PLOS medicine that seeks to tease out the relationship between obesity on the one hand and COVID-19 on the other, distinguishing the effect of obesity from other related factors like diabetes. Let's listen. Lauren, thanks so much for joining Public Health On Call. Please tell me about the paper that you've been studying.
Hey, Josh. I'm really happy to be here. So today I'm going to be talking a bit about a paper that looks at obesity and mortality among patients who were diagnosed with COVID. And I will say this is a full population, not just hospitalized individuals. So they include anyone who is diagnosed with COVID and belongs to the Kaiser Permanente Southern California Integrated Healthcare Organization. And a notable thing about this paper is it was one of the first and largest studies of the association between BMI and mortality.
There are a lot of Kaiser members in Southern California, so it sounds like it's a pretty big study.
Yes, exactly. So there's actually about 4.7 million members of the Kaiser Permanente Southern California organization, and this study includes about 7,000 patients who were diagnosed with COVID between February 13th and May 2nd, 2020, so in the early phase of the pandemic.
And what did the researchers find?
So it's actually quite interesting. Their goal was to estimate the independent effect of BMI on risk for death. And they really wanted to disentangle the effect of BMI from other obesity-related conditions, such as history of diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, previous heart attack, any other medications they were on, time of diagnosis, and even some neighborhood factors like income and education. So what they do is they look at BMI categorized according to the National Institute of Health subcategories. So this is categorized as underweight, normal weight, overweight, obesity, classes 1, 2, and 3. And then they subsequently stratify these results by age groups, grouping people as over 60 or less than 60, and by sex. And what they find is a J-shaped association between BMI and mortality within 21 days of COVID-19 diagnosis. And that J shape means that people with the lowest BMI group have an increased risk for mortality. And then after you pass the normal BMI range, that risk continues to increase as your BMI category increases.
Could you give a sense of the size of the increase in risk as people's either BMI is on the low side for that first part of the J curve or on the high side? Like how much more risk are we talking about?
Exactly. So in the full study population, the risk for death for people in the highest BMI category compared to people with a normal BMI range was about four. They have about four times the risk of dying within 21 days of COVID-19 diagnosis. But one of the more interesting findings is that when you stratify by age and you look at younger individuals, that risk is even greater. So among individuals who are less than 60, those who have a BMI that's higher than 45 have over 12 times the risk of death compared to those with a normal BMI. But when you look at this among older individuals, there's really that risk is quite attenuated. So even the highest BMI group just has around a three times the risk. And the biggest factor for predicting outcome in that older group is age.
Got it. But that's a pretty high risk. I mean, sometimes people talk about a 30% increase in risk, a 40% increase in risk. But you're talking about three, four, and for younger people, 12 times the increase in risk.
Right. And I think one of the key things we need to think about here is the absolute risk for mortality. So I will mention that among individuals less than 60 who have the highest BMI group, so this is a BMI greater than 45, their absolute risk of death is about 3%. Whereas every individual who's greater than 60, individuals who are sick who in the 61 to 70 range have a risk of death higher than 3%. So I think this gets to be important when we're considering, you know, how we allocate vaccines. And there was a lot of push in the beginning to allocate vaccines based on your age group. And I think that makes a lot of sense when people's age is greater than 60. But as we start to get down into the younger age groups, it's more important to disentangle these effects of BMI and age and really trying to figure out which is more important.
Got it. Well, thank you so much for explaining that research so clearly.
Yeah, of course.
Sabina, welcome to Public Health On Call. Tell me about the paper that you've been looking into.
Well, it's great to be with you, Josh. Thank you for having me. The study that I'd like to talk about is one that was recently published in the Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report on the relationship between body mass index and COVID-19 severity and death. And this study was conducted by researchers at the CDC's Division of Nutrition, Physical Activity, and Obesity.
So before we get to the details of the study, when the CDC publishes a paper like that, people really listen. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely.
And why do you think the CDC focused on this question in the first place?
That's a great question, Josh. We have seen study after study showing an association between obesity or BMI and negative outcomes of COVID-19 infection. But many of these associations occurred outside of a pre-specified hypothesis. So for example, it arose in addition to other risk factors that were being observed. And of course, all of these studies had smaller sample sizes. So what's unique about this study is the sheer size of it allows it to study this association in a more rigorous way and also in a more granular way.
So tell me what they did.
So they used data from a large hospital-based database called the Premier Healthcare Database, which includes both inpatient and emergency department data from hospitals across the U.S. And one of the advantages of this data source is that it isn't tied to a particular payer, like Medicare or a private insurance. So it includes the full range of patients in those facilities. And for this particular study, the investigators used data from the 238 hospitals that reported patient height and weight. And they selected all patients who were aged 18 and older who were seen in either the emergency department or inpatient from March 1st to December 31st of 2020 with a COVID-19 diagnosis. And using this data, they were able to calculate body mass index for more than 71,000 adults hospitalized with COVID-19. Now, when they also included patients with COVID-19 who were seen in the emergency department, they had a total of more than 148,000 patients.
Wow. So they're looking across all of these patients to try to understand the association of body mass index with the course of this illness.
Exactly. So they actually assessed four different outcomes related to COVID-19 severity, and only the first one, inpatient hospitalization, was assessed among that full larger sample that I mentioned. The other three outcomes were assessed among the subset of hospitalized patients, and those outcomes were admission to the intensive care unit, the use of invasive mechanical ventilation, and death.
And so what did the CDC report to the country?
Yes, well, at the higher end of BMI, the likelihood of hospitalization, ICU admission, mechanical ventilation, and death all increased with increasing severity of obesity relative to those with a healthy weight. And the risk associated with obesity was strongest for mechanical ventilation, actually, followed by death. In contrast, the association that they found with ICU admission was quite modest. These associations were independent of age, sex, race and ethnicity, payer type, urbanicity, and U.S. Census region of the hospital, as well as the month of admission. At the lower end of the BMI, there were actually two stories. BMI had a J-shaped association with hospitalization, ICU admission, and death, meaning that the risk among underweight adults was higher than that of adults with a healthy weight or overweight. On the other hand, when looking at the risk of mechanical ventilation, the data showed a linear and very strong dose response increase across the full range of BMI values, meaning that here the risk was the lowest among those who were underweight.
Interesting. Maybe that suggests that there's something about obesity and COVID interacting that makes breathing harder, something like that, and therefore a more continuous increase in risk for mechanical ventilation.
Absolutely, and potentially more of a mechanism through the respiratory effects of COVID-19 as opposed to other organ systems that are impacted as well.
Can I ask you, did the researchers try to separate out the impact of obesity from, say, the impact of diabetes, which goes along with obesity?
Yeah, this is a great question. And the investigators made the choice not to adjust for those factors in the primary results that they report. However, they do present sensitivity analysis where they adjusted for different comorbidities that we know are likely to affect COVID-19 outcomes. And so these were hypertension, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, asthma, heart disease, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and cancer. And the size of the relative risk for obesity with the outcomes decreased after they accounted for these factors. And for some of the outcomes, the lowest category of obesity became non-significantly different from the healthy weight individuals. However, for the outcomes of mechanical ventilation and death in particular, the attenuation wasn't very large. So the results, in other words, were robust for adjustment to these other comorbidities that many of them might be partly impacted by obesity itself.
So it sounds like obesity is a big deal for severe COVID.
It is, absolutely, with a very strong association, particularly with the respiratory pathway, as well as with death.
Great. Well, thank you so much for walking me through that paper.
Thank you.
Nicholas, thank you so much for coming back to the podcast. One of the challenges in understanding the relationship between weight, obesity, and COVID is that there are a number of different factors that often coincide with people. They may have obesity as well as diabetes. And I understand you've been looking at a paper that is trying to figure out the role of each of these factors. Is that right?
That's right, Josh. Yeah, the problem with disentangling the effects of any given risk factor on the outcome is that these things are sometimes correlated, and sometimes we can't measure confounding variables that might bias observed associations.
So how did the researchers in this study try to look precisely at, say, the effect of diabetes versus the effect of obesity versus the effect of other types of risk factors?
So these researchers used a technique called Mendelian randomization, which can seem a little bit magical in what it promises to do.
I might regret asking this question, but can you explain the technique of Mendelian randomization?
Sure. So if you have an exposure that you're interested in, and you're concerned that the relationship between an exposure and an outcome, in this case, COVID-19, might be confounded by things you can measure and things you can't measure, then this technique goes a step back and looks at genetic variation, which itself is essentially randomly distributed. And this genetic variation, if it is associated with the exposure that you're interested in, then what you can do is look at the association between that genetic variant, which can only affect the outcome through the exposure of interest, and you can back out the effect of the exposure on the outcome.
Now, that's a pretty intense explanation for this. I want to ask if maybe you have an analogy that would help maybe people intuitively grasp the kind of analysis that's going on here.
Well, I'm not sure that it can ever really be intuitive, but this is an example of an instrumental variable analysis, which is maybe familiar to economists. And a classic example of this is, say you're interested in the effect of smoking behavior on some outcome, but you're worried that smoking behavior is associated with all kinds of other things that might affect the outcome. Well, if you look then at the effect of a cigarette tax on that outcome, you can be fairly certain that the cigarette tax can only affect that outcome through smoking behavior, because a tax might reduce cigarette consumption by a certain amount. So if you see that a cigarette tax is associated with the outcome, then you can back out the causal effect of smoking behavior on the outcome.
I think I'm getting it. So let's say you were wondering whether it's smoking or alcohol consumption that causes an adverse health effect. And you could look at both a cigarette tax and an alcohol tax separately to see whether they have an effect. That might be an easier way to figure that out than trying to disentangle people who are smoking a little more or drinking a little more.
That's right. That's right. Now, the devil is in the details, so you need to be certain that the assumptions underlying Mendelian randomization are met. And a crucial assumption is that that genetic variant can't affect the outcome through any other pathway. It has to go through that exposure that you're interested in. And in this case, we're talking about obesity.
Got it. Well, we'll circle back to that assumption. But in the meantime, tell me what this paper on Mendelian randomization actually found.
Yeah, so they looked at people entirely of European ancestry, because they were looking at people who contributed information to a genome-wide association study from 22 different cohort studies, predominantly in Europe. And they looked at 17 different risk factors, including diabetes, coronary artery disease, and BMI as a proxy for obesity. And they looked at the risk of acquiring infection with SARS-CoV-2 and the risk of hospitalization with severe COVID-19. And of all of those comparisons that they made, which 17 times 2, 34 different associations, the only one that was statistically significant was the association between higher BMI and higher risk for COVID-19 hospitalization.
So the impact of obesity on the severity of COVID looked pretty strong and independent in that result.
It did. And then that when they adjusted for things that might be in the causal pathway, in other words, things that are affected by obesity itself, like diabetes, those associations went away, which indicated to the authors that there was an effect of BMI on severe COVID-19, but that it occurred through, it was mediated by these other obesity-related conditions.
So that seems like it is a little bit more complicated than saying it's just being overweight that creates the risk. It's overweight and all the things that can happen because you're overweight that might create the risk.
That's right. For example, the results of the study wouldn't say support the notion that someone who has a high BMI but doesn't have any other underlying risk factors would be at higher risk for COVID-19, that the effect is through these other factors.
So the upshot is clearly, again, a strong risk of body mass index on the severity of COVID, and it may be something that the body mass index itself is responsible for, directly or indirectly.
Yeah, although there are, of course, reasons to be cautious about these results. There are indications that the underlying assumptions of Mendelian randomization are not met, in fact. So I would be a little bit cautious in interpreting these results causally. Now, for things like prioritizing who gets the vaccine and for identifying patients at higher risk, it may not matter so much what the underlying causal pathway is. Being a risk factor might be good enough. And these certainly reinforce what we've seen from other observational studies that higher BMI is associated with higher risk of severe COVID-19.
Great. Well, thank you, Nicholas. I'm always cautious in interpreting the results of Mendelian randomization. I really appreciate your joining me.
Thanks very much, Josh.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outland. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holes Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.